Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Transatlantic Television Drama, Industries, Programs, and Fans. Edited by Matt Hills, Michele Hilmes, and Roberta Pearson. Narrated by Shaun Grindell. Introduction. Flying the flag for contemporary Transatlantic Television Drama, Michele Hilmes, Roberta Pearson, and Matt Hills. A tide of high-quality transnational television drama is currently sweeping the world, according to critics and scholars, as well as the popular press. Speaking what has become the global language of serial television, often co-produced and available on a range of both terrestrial and digital platforms, the new transnational television drama has developed not only global appeal, but innovative new modes of production, distribution, and reception. Nowhere is the transnational exchange of television drama more vital than between Britain and the United States, where it builds on a more than 60-year history of transatlantic import, adaptation, and co-production. This book explores the British-American connection in the context of contemporary transnational television drama, focusing on key programs and practices that reflect the current situation in the transatlantic television industry, its programs, and its audiences. Subsequent chapters will analyze some of the most widely discussed and highly rated programs on the transatlantic circuit. From recent series like Game of Thrones, Black Mirror, Orphan Black, Episodes, Elementary, and Sherlock, to those like Masterpiece and Doctor Who, that have long and active histories of transnational circulation, to others whose transnational success speaks to more specific underlying currents in the process of exchange, adaptation, and cooperation, such as Supernatural, Downton Abbey, Rome, and Parade's End. The Trouble with Television. The transatlantic relationship that produces such programs and sends them out worldwide is just one part of the larger transnational exchange that also circulates films, music, literature, theatre, art, and virtually every form of modern culture. But television drama is, in many ways, a uniquely contentious kind of transnational space. Because of the historical development of television as an institution and expressive form deeply tied to the nation, to national culture, national mandates, national politics, national regulation, national viewership, and, in many cases, national ownership, it has long walked a difficult and highly debated line between the national and the non-national, between creating and broadcasting programs produced in the home nation that reflect and support home culture, and importing programs and practices from elsewhere, most ubiquitously and contentiously from the United States. Until recently, most public service systems limited non-national programs to a certain percentage of the broadcast schedule. In Britain, until the 1990s, it was 14%, but not all from the United States. And transnational co-production was a controversial practice. However, UK audiences have always had more access to US programs than their US counterparts did to UK programs. In the 1950s, both the BBC and ITV turned to the United States for content to expand their schedules, and US programs remained prominent through the 1970s. The channel fragmentation of the 1980s resulted in the main terrestrial broadcasters, the BBC and ITV, branding around domestically produced drama. But smaller channels, C4, Channel 5, and the Sky channels, frequently used US content in their branding. Today, with relatively rare exceptions, most peak time content on the BBC and ITV is British, but US content is readily found elsewhere. In the United States, television's national bias was more a matter of economics than public policy. Hollywood rarely saw much profit in importing programs from elsewhere, and instead favoured Americanized adaptations of shows originated in other countries. Such adaptations were potentially far more remunerative to their producers than simply buying and airing an imported show off the shelf, since the new wholly owned version could be sold internationally as well as domestically, with profits going to its American producer. A good recent example of this practice is Ugly Betty, the US version of the originally Colombian show Yo Soy Betty La Fea, which became a global hit in its own right. Some US adaptations, much altered from the original, succeeded, like All in the Family, adapted from the British original Till Death Us Do Part, or more recently the US version of The Office, and went on to earn their American producers vast sums, as intended. Most sank without a trace, proving that the textual integrity of creative drama and comedy can't always be stretched to fit. But with a very few exceptions, Masterpiece Theatre on PBS after 1971, the Arts and Entertainment A&E cable network after 1984, until recent decades, US viewers had little access to drama and comedy from Britain, or from anywhere else for that matter, at least not on mainstream channels. The rise of new distribution platforms, beginning with cable, satellite channels and video cassettes in the late 1980s, and going on to DVDs, expanded cable, and most transformatively, the digital streaming services so widely available today, have facilitated the distribution of international content in both countries. Platforms like Sky, Netflix, Amazon, iTunes, HBO, and many others, as these chapters discuss, not only distribute programs originated in national context to broader audiences around the world, but in many cases have become active producers of original television drama, often through co-production deals that can range from upfront distribution guarantees to joint ventures that contribute funding to national broadcasters for transnationally oriented shows, to series commissioned and co-produced by the largely US-based services themselves, often working with international partners. In this kind of complex network of relationships, the meanings of both national and transnational have become contentious. As Karen Petruska and Faye Woods explore in their chapter, a program's original identity can no longer be understood as solely the property of a text, a show about Americans set in New York, or of the location or ownership of its production company, a show produced by British creators working in London, or even of its primary audience, a show originally broadcast in Canada but with a large international audience, but as a product of a complex system of transnational negotiations that occur at many levels, from national policy to financing to producing to writing and acting and post-production and marketing, as well as in reception conditions determined both by national broadcasters and by global internet platforms. Such practices begin to demand a new term, less restrictive than international, less vaguely comprehensive than global, designating a new way of not only performing, but thinking about cultural flows and relationships. Putting the trans in transnational. The term transnational has been used to designate a wide variety of phenomena, from transnational corporations to transnational flows of people, money, ideas, and media. Most uses position it in contradistinction both to the international and the global, and note that it implies going beyond the nation and the national in some way, while still drawing on national identity for at least part of its coherence. Pierre-Yves Saunier, in his essay on the term in the Palgrave Dictionary of Transnational History, points out that its first use in English occurred as early as 1862 in the Princeton Review, reviewing work done by a German scholar of philology on the transnational constitution of languages. He also notes that it was frequently employed as a synonym for transcontinental when talking about highways in the 1910s and 1920s, actually an incorrect usage, since trans as a prefix means going beyond, not across. But he argues it was Randolph Bourne's use of the term in his article Transnational America, in the Atlantic Monthly in July 1916, that set it into sociological and political use, a bit ahead of its time. America is coming to be not a nationality, but a transnationality, a weaving back and forth with the other lands of many threads of all sizes and colours, claimed Bourne. Saunier mentions that Bourne's editor was not very happy with the failure of this definition to adhere to the white Anglo-Saxon Protestant identity project, then dominant in the United States. But it is significant that the term first arises and then spreads in relationship to the United States and its culture, making it particularly apt in talking about an area of media research, often associated with a rampant kind of American cultural imperialism. Saunier finds that transnational remained primarily an American usage through the 1950s and 1960s, until it was taken up by the larger academic community in the early 1970s, in Europe in particular, as the beginning of the assertion of a pan-European identity sparked by the emergent European economic community. In 1971, the conference Transnational Relations brought social and political scientists from around the world to Harvard, but in the United States, the field called International Relations quickly replaced this term, reasserting the primacy of the nation as the essential foundational unit of politics. In Europe, the transnational persisted, however, and began to be used alongside globalization, often without making any key distinctions. In the 1980s, the influential work of Arjun Appadurai attached the prefix trans to a variety of phenomena, including the Center for Transcultural Studies, established in 1986 under Appadurai's direction in cooperation between the universities of Chicago and Pennsylvania, out of which arose the Project for Transnational Cultural Studies and the journal Public Culture. In the field of anthropology, it also gained ground in the context of discussing migratory populations and diasporas. By the 1990s, according to Saunier, it even attained a political opposition. Conservatives used the term transnational progressives to indicate a group that, in his words, includes academics, NGOs, activists, philanthropic foundation officers, European Union and United Nations civil servants, a global elite on the march to wash away national citizenship and democracy in favour of world government. In media studies, transnational has most often been used in the socio-cultural sense to denote flows of influence, dispersion of media through technology, and trade in textual formats and forms. It is not hard to recognize a transnational corporation, a transnational business deal, a transnational satellite network. Many references are made to the transnational circulation of texts and to the transnational circuits of production that may center on Hollywood or on other media capitals, to use Michael Curtin's term. Creative personnel in film and television frequently have transnational careers, and it is recognized that transnational capital underwrites everything. However, when it comes to critical cultural analysis, the acknowledgement of transnational intertextuality, the way that the national and beyond national interact in specific texts and practices of production and reception, has largely been reserved for literary studies and the realm of the serious arts, where it is not perceived as threatening that texts might have not only national and local, but also transnational authorship, narratives, references, and meanings. In fact, such elements are valued. Not so for the television text, where the dominance of the national framework has rendered elements of transnationality deeply suspicious, evidence of cultural imperialism, and even of a dangerous denationalizing of culture. Tracing the transatlantic. Yet such programs belong to an ongoing system of production that has always been transnational, with long-standing flows of influence between nations and regions, foremost among them the transatlantic relationship between the United Kingdom and the United States. Beginning in the 1960s, but accelerating since the rise of digital distribution, The United Kingdom and the United States forged a system of transnational negotiation of dramatic and documentary forms that shaped television programming in both nations, and led to types of cooperation and co-production that contributed to a broader transnationality worldwide. All of the chapters in this volume deal in some way with the struggles of industries, producers, programs, and audiences to negotiate the tensions between the national and transnational that arise in the new digital environment. When the BBC co-produces with Masterpiece, is it using British license fees to make programs for Americans? When Netflix declares that a production originated by the United Kingdom's Channel 4 and broadcast in Britain has become a Netflix original, has original lost all sense of its traditional meaning, rooted in national origins? What does it mean when the leading show on a channel branded as British and aimed at Americans, BBC America, is produced by Canadians, as with Orphan Black? When American fans of British shows display ignorance about British culture and idioms, should British fans object or just give in to American monoculture? These are some of the questions addressed in the following chapters. Film theorist Mehdi Ort's work provides terms that are useful for understanding these blurred lines. In her essay on the plurality of cinematic transnationalism, Yort argues that transnationalism must be understood first as a matter of degree. There are both strong and weak types of transnationalism, relating not only to circumstances of production, distribution, and reception, but also to the textual project of the film itself. The question here is how central the various national negotiations are to the film's conception and authorship. How much the film deliberately brings issues of national and transnational cultural positions into both its production processes and the narrative and diegesis. Clearly, a program like Episodes, explored in this volume by Jonathan Bignall, falls into the strong category, since not only is it made by British producers working for HBO in Los Angeles, but exploration of British and American perceived cultural differences, in television, no less, for true reflexivity, forms the fundamental premise of the text. A program like Elementary, on the other hand, though it draws fairly obviously on the classic Sherlock Holmes original, rarely references its British roots, is entirely produced and set in the United States, and in fact significantly reimagines key elements of the original text, as Roberta Pearson describes, fairly weak transnationalism. A further distinction made by Yort pertains to the amount of transnational involvement the text itself admits to, or marks. Are its transnational qualities overtly visible within the text, or can they only be discovered by an investigation of its production circumstances? In other words, is transnationality strongly marked, weakly marked, or unmarked in the text itself? Is it clearly perceptible to the viewer? Is it perceptible but relatively unimportant to the project of the text, or is it hidden? A text might be strongly marked as transnational, clearly a product of different national production spaces and personnel, dealing with issues relating to the interaction of transnational identities, again like Episodes or like Black Mirror, as argued by Matt Hills in his chapter. Or it might be completely unmarked, its transnational elements invisible or irrelevant to the viewer, as in Game of Thrones. Analyzing television production, texts, and reception along these lines reveals much about the ways that national identity functions in today's televisual context. We might also need to add another category, the falsely marked. As far back as the 1950s, British television offered The Adventures of Robin Hood as an original British television programme. Even the most attentive viewer could not have known that it was largely written and produced by blacklisted American writers relocated to England, writing under pseudonyms. Until very recently, PBS played down its growing influence on Masterpiece's primarily UK-produced period dramas, a tactic useful on both sides of the Atlantic, Since Americans valued precisely the show's Britishness, and UK viewers found the idea of American influence on such shows objectionable. By strongly, yet somewhat misleadingly, making such productions as British and minimizing the growing amount of American influence, Masterpiece helped to ensure the survival of a certain kind of quality drama in both countries, as Michele Hilmes argues in her chapter. With Rome, this transnational erasure was reversed, as the BBC highlighted HBO's involvement, while HBO minimized the show's British production, with the Italian broadcaster Rai's participation completely erased, as Robin Nelson points out. Netflix's marking of certain shows as original seems to be a clear case of this. Such marking occurs not only in the shows themselves, as chapters in the second part discuss, but in the discourse surrounding them. This includes both industry discourse, the focus of chapters in the first part, and audience and reception discourse, as found in the third part. Behind the screens, the importance of the transatlantic market. However acknowledged or obscured, there is no doubt that few other channels of transnational exchange have been and continue to be as lucrative and globally influential as the UK-US connection. Collectively, the United States and the United Kingdom strongly dominate the international television trade. In 2007, the United States accounted for an estimated 76% of all finished programs exported worldwide, compared to 7% from the United Kingdom, which followed in second place. 10 years later, the two countries remain the dominant creative markets, with the US the largest exporter of scripted content, and the United Kingdom the world leader for exported formats. In 2014, the five distributors accounting for the top 15 best-performing fictional series per territory were CBS Studios International, Warner Brothers, International Television Distribution, 21st Century Fox Television Distribution, BBC Worldwide, and Disney Media Distribution. More evidence of the Anglo-American dominance. The six major US television production studios, Warner, Disney, Fox, Universal, Columbia, and Paramount, rely on television licensing for their profit margins. In 2004, licensing revenues amounted to around $16 billion. These studios' single richest source of profits. By 2012, international sales brought in as much as half of the revenue that the studios get for new dramas. Despite benefiting from one of the larger and more profitable domestic markets, the studios increasingly look overseas for television licensing fees, now so central to their business models. As Shaun Shimpack states, facing the saturation of domestic markets, the global audience is now an increasingly integral part of programming and fiscal strategy for the US television industry. International distribution deals have become a necessity for deficit-financed television productions, particularly expensive hour drama series. American television networks place similar emphasis on international sales and distribution. CBS Corporation, formerly Viacom, in its 2016 annual report to the Securities and Exchange Commission, stated that its principal strategy is to create and acquire premium content that is widely accepted by audiences and to generate both advertising and non-advertising revenues from the distribution of this content on multiple media platforms and to various geographic locations, and that its primary opportunities for revenue growth include expanding the distribution of its content internationally. The CBS report offers some insights into its international television licensing revenues and strategies. Since the typical network licensing fee charged to first-run buyers is lower than actual production costs, the company recoups costs and earns a profit through secondary distribution, which includes domestic syndication, digital streaming, and international licensing. International sales are usually made within 1 year of the US network run, Although in some cases, such as Elementary, programs are sold to international buyers before their domestic debuts. In 2015, international sales of NCIS, Elementary, and CSI significantly boosted the CBS bottom line. While in 2014, a 3% decrease in domestic licensing revenues was partially offset by higher international television licensing revenues. CBS reports that the UK market yields a higher percentage of revenues than any other single national territory, 17% in 2015 and 15% in 2016. The second and third most profitable territories are Canada, 13% in 2015 and in 2016, and the combined category of Other Europe, 35% in 2015 and 39% in 2016. The combination indicating that besides the United Kingdom and Canada, no other single country represents a sufficiently large market to be broken out. Just as the United Kingdom is the single most important market for the largest American producers, the United States is the single most important market for the UK industry. Like the US studios, the UK television production sector receives a significant share of its profits from the international market. In 2016, sales totaled £1.3 billion, up 10% from the year before. Exports of finished television programming, as opposed to formats, represented £668 million of that total. The United States was, as always, the United Kingdom's largest export market, with £497 million in sales, up 16% from the year before. BBC Worldwide, the commercial distribution arm of the non-profit public service BBC, and one of the biggest players in the international television trade, made £305.7 pounds in the North American market in 2016. The company's annual report does not provide the percentage of the profits deriving solely from the US market, but it's probable that Worldwide's activities contributed significantly to the £497 million UK distributors earned in the United States in that year, since Worldwide is the most significant UK player in the international market. It is increasingly the case that the production patterns of US and UK television industries cannot be understood without reference to international distribution. As Roberta Pearson argues in her chapter in this book, US television series are now being renewed, despite poor domestic ratings, if their international sales remain healthy. Hence, global distribution has a direct influence upon domestic television production, which may conceivably lead to programs designed to succeed in the international as well as the domestic markets. Such programs might, for example, feature international casts or locations, as was the case with Lost and Heroes, or conform to well-established and successful genres, such as the procedural. UK domestic production is similarly impacted by decisions concerning potentially profitable international content. For example, over the 5 years from 2011 to 2016, BBC Worldwide deposited almost £1.3 billion in revenues into the BBC's coffers, money that has supplemented the licence fee to keep audiences in the UK informed, educated and entertained. However, these audiences may now be consuming programmes designed not for their own information, education and entertainment, but for the rest of the world, as producers come under pressure to produce less locally specific content in favour of content that travels well, a concern that has affected the transatlantic TV trade since its earliest decades. This may mean more programmes resembling Downton Abbey and Sherlock, and fewer resembling Broken, the recent BBC series about the travails of a priest and his parishioners in Merseyside in the age of austerity, which some may argue better serves the needs of domestic viewers than the international hits. In addition to affecting domestic production patterns, the transatlantic television trade also has an impact on domestic distribution, with imported content used to attract niche audiences and brand domestic channels, a topic addressed by several of this volume's authors. Clearly, it is no longer possible to talk about television from a primarily national perspective. Television studies' traditional focus on national industries and national content has recently given way to a third wave of scholarship with a more transnational approach. Roots of transatlantic scholarship. Three distinctive waves of scholarship mark our understanding of television's global circulation. During the first wave of international television scholarship, from the 1960s into the 1980s, the main emphasis of research centered on the impact of imported American television on national cultures, linked to fears of Americanization more generally. Broadcasters around the globe struggled to develop a national television culture and a domestic industry despite the lure of cheap US imports, and those from other regionally dominant nations, even as the international trade in programs began to prosper. The enormous global success of the primetime serial drama Dallas in 1980 to 1981 brought such fears to a head, giving rise to iconic terms of anxiety like wall-to-wall Dallas and Dallasification. The second wave of international television research, from the mid-1980s to the late 1990s, responded to political and technological developments of the period, including Thatcher and Reagan-era deregulation and the rise of cable and satellite television, with their promise of more channels and increased commercial competition. Anxieties over the erosion of the public sphere and the shift of emphasis from citizen to consumer circulated globally as well, as public service broadcasters were mandated to downsize their operation and outsource production, and the tide of American programs continued to increase. However, as cultural studies began to make an impact on the academy, more scholars turned their attention to how viewers actually used and responded to global television. We also begin to see some of the first uses of the term transnational over the more common global, as in the Skormand and Schroeder volume Media Cultures, Reappraising Transnational Media, 1992. By the late 1990s, a third wave of scholarship began to develop out of the growing collision of digital media with traditional broadcasting, as well as the impact of increasing population migrations and the expanding influence of the European Union and its transnational project. As new media capitals rose, Bombay, Hong Kong, Lagos, Seoul, new ways of theorizing cultural flows began to appear, and with them, considerations of media culture, willing to reconsider the old oppositions and to analyze ever more complex circuits of exchange. Scholars began to explore aspects of the international television trade from a more transnational perspective, providing a background to this volume's focus on the US and UK relationship, including the function of key transaction nodes of the transnational television industry, such as MIPCOM, Marché International des Programmes de Communication, held each year in Cannes, where buyers and sellers from around the world come together to bargain for global TV properties and exchange ideas. Timothy Havens examines distribution, acquisition, and scheduling with a primary focus on gatekeepers, the executives who make decisions about global trade, and serve as mediators between transnational media conglomerates and national audiences. Others began to examine how practices formed in the era of strong nationalism had shifted to accommodate new transnational imperatives, such as co-production, and the ways that broadcasters integrated transnational texts into their domestic environments. Another strand of third-wave research gathered around the late 1990s, format revolution, as Jean Chalabet terms it. During this period, concepts adapted from territory to territory began to cross borders in great numbers, establishing the format trade as a thriving global industry, and turning scholarly attention to the transnational television trade through a focus on the development, circulation, and reception of globally successful reality programs such as Big Brother, Survivor, and the various idols. Since the format trade is based on licensing not a finished program, but a structuring concept or set of rules, often organized around some kind of competition, it is designed to be effectively transnational, adaptable to a wide range of international languages, cultures, and topics, breaking out of the national and international duality that previously dominated. The first international smash format hit, Who Wants to Be a Millionaire, originated in the United Kingdom in 1998 and quickly spread around the globe, followed by hundreds of others. Since then, scholarship on international television formats has flourished, as has the genre, allowing an approach based more on transnational negotiations of content than on circulation of national productions. The last decade has produced several works key to the current project. Jeanette Steamer's Selling Television, British Television in the Global Marketplace, revealed how the British television industry, second only to the United States in terms of television exportation, distributes content to key markets in the United States, Europe, Australia, New Zealand, and East Asia. It specifically examines the ways in which companies such as BBC Worldwide and Granada International, now absorbed by ITV Studios, export programs and formats and participate in co-productions. In 2012, two books appeared that focused directly on the US-UK reciprocal relationship. Hilmes' Network Nations, which traces the history of transatlantic exchange between Britain and the United States from the 1920s through the 1970s, and Elk Weissman's Transnational Television Drama, Special Relations and Mutual Influence Between the US and UK. Weissman picks up the story from the 1970s to the present, focusing on topics including the role of perceived cultural difference in importation, the influence of UK programmes upon US broadcasters, the activities of transnational audiences in online spaces, and the growing importance of co-production. But in television time, 2012 is an eon ago. Since then, the international expansion of mostly US-based digital subscription services such as Netflix, Amazon Prime, and HBO, as well as more regional subscription video on demand, SVOD platforms, has radically rearranged relationships between audiences and ways of viewing television, and between traditional terrestrial and cable broadcasters and the way that programs are made, distributed, and promoted. Largely, though not entirely, removing the element of scheduled weekly broadcasts, so basic to the television experience across the 20th century, SVOD services have created a new concept, more similar to a library than to a broadcast service, into which viewers can dip according to their own tastes and schedules. Though advertiser-supported television still remains strong, as do many but not all public broadcasters, the subscription model has become a vital adjunct to the contemporary television universe, to which terrestrial broadcasters and cable channels have had to adjust. As a result, scripted drama has even more firmly established itself as the most valuable commodity in the international television trade, and the US and UK television industries direct more and more of their finances and efforts into its production and international distribution. Steamers, in a 2016 article updating her earlier book, observes that in the increasingly volatile environment of an industry coping with the massive disruption of streaming television, drama continues to drive the sales of the larger UK production companies. A recent report on the impressive growth of UK television exports stated that investment in premium content for scripted and non-scripted programmes was believed to be central to future export growth. Indeed, drama now makes up around half of BBC Worldwide's total investment, as a result of a deliberate rebalancing from other genres. The second-ranked UK international distributor, ITV Studios, estimates that the global content market is growing at about 5% per annum, with some genres, such as drama, growing more rapidly than others. To capitalise on this, our strategy remains to develop, own and manage content rights in genres that return and travel internationally, namely drama, entertainment, and factual entertainment. Drama, says the distributor, has particular value as standout, original content becomes brand-defining for both broadcasters and OTT, over-the-top players. As each company strives to find the hits that strengthen the brand, and attract new subscribers both at home and abroad, House of Cards, Man in the High Castle, Game of Thrones. Their rivalry, argues Gillian Doyle, has significantly boosted demand for one particular category of content, high-end drama. The impetus for SVODs to build recognition through investment in big statement drama content has encouraged a retaliatory response from incumbent pay TV services that can afford it as such. In the United Kingdom, BSkyB. As Saul Vennett, Chief Operating Officer of Lookout Point, a leading UK independent production and distribution company, told Doyle, there has been a knock-on effect to other services, so it's not just the SVOD services who are now looking for high-end drama. There is a House of Cards effect across the industry. When you look at just the scale of the investment Netflix made, and other networks are competing for space, like Sky, feel they need to match that with really big commissions, like Fortitude, in the same way. The essays in this volume, then, aim to contribute to our understanding of the role that television drama plays in this radically changed media universe, especially prominent in the relationship between two of its largest and most deeply intertwined producing and consuming nations. Doing so means reflecting on audience practices and fan identities as much as industrial and textual structures. Historically, the study of transatlantic flows of capital and meaning, along with strong and weak variants of transnationalism or marked and unmarked textualities, hasn't always considered how audiences contribute to these factors. But third-wave research has tended to be more attentive to the role of audiences and fans within such processes. For instance, the previously mentioned Transnational Television Drama by Elk Weissman includes a chapter specifically exploring how transnational audiences for forensic science drama, Silent Witness, Waking the Dead, and CSI, use other imports, as well as texts, sharing the country of origin, as evaluative points of comparison. Despite a strong transatlantic awareness and contextualization, supposed national differences are constantly reiterated in these audiences' online reviews. This raises the question of how contemporary television drama has not only been consumed as variously transnational, but also potentially co-created as transatlantic by its digital fans, reinforcing or contesting transnational discourses circulating officially in and around US and UK television dramas. Transatlantic fandom. As waves of transnational scholarship have developed, so too have cultural and media technological contexts altered, reframing how transatlantic TV audiences tend to make sense of their viewing practices. The first wave of scholarship, marked by a focus on US cultural imperialism, positioned emblematic programs such as Dallas as a problematic disturbance, likely looming large only in the ivory towers of the policymakers and other guardians of the national culture. In the millions of living rooms where the TV set is switched on to Dallas, the issue is rather one of pleasure, argued Ian Ung in Watching Dallas, thereby instead exemplifying second-wave scholarship's turn to cultural and audience studies. However, in first and second wave theorizing, there was a pronounced asymmetry in approaches to, and in the discourses and experiences of, transatlantic audiences. Whereas the United Kingdom's mass audiences for popular US dramas had to be distanced from accusations of cultural imperialism, a situation that resulted in Ian Ung's 1980s account of Dallas and its emotional realism being altogether disarticulated from national identity, by contrast, US audiences for selected public service productions from Britain were positioned as part of an elite taste culture. Masterpiece theatre had been very deliberately branded as non-American via its UK-English spelling from its origination in 1971, after its working title, The Best of the BBC, was superseded. Unlike transatlantic audiences on the UK side, who were presumed to be under threat from American influence and subjected to a cultural lowering in taste in this pre-HBO era, US audiences were assumed to be elevated and distinguished via their consumption of quality British TV, often adaptations of literary classics or historical dramas, as marked by the name of its emblematic show, not television, but theatre. The more recent third wave of transnational scholarship confronts a very different world of transatlantic fans and audiences, with this asymmetry having given way to a relative convergence of US and UK audience discourses. Today, UK fans of quality US TV drama can make just as much claim to affirming their place as a cultural elite, distinguished from the national cultural mainstream, as can their US counterparts, who embrace the best of British TV imports. Conversely, US fans can enjoy British drama on different levels, including genres and formats that Masterpiece would never consider, sci-fi and fantasy in particular. Transatlantic difference has readily and pervasively become a marker of audience distinction on both sides of the Atlantic, it would seem, with the Reading Contemporary Television book series, published by I.B. Torres, involving audience study in relation to the likes of Sex and the City, CSI, and Doctor Who. Herbert Schwab has argued that the book series belongs to a new genre of books that could be called fan-scholar literature, but he views this as a negative development in certain ways. What is at stake reading The Sopranos, Sex and the City, or Desperate Housewives? Everybody knows that Tony Soprano is a complex character. Everybody notes the ironies involved in the construction of Carrie Bradshaw, or in the nostalgia-driven suburbia of Wisteria Lane. It is an extension of a pleasure already granted by the object. This easy-to-read television puts the television scholar in a very stable position of repeating exactly what the authors and producers intended to achieve. Here, contemporary television drama's readability and its construction as quality TV addressing, if not interpolating, an educated fan audience possessing high levels of cultural capital, suggests that the transatlantic audience pleasures of these US TV dramas are somehow pre-programmed as matters of distinction. Even scholarship is seemingly caught up in this process, no longer challenging and transgressing the meanings and values of TV drama, and thus no longer being akin to Ian Ung's defense of the pleasures of Dallas, which operated contra discourses of cultural imperialism. But to dismiss third-wave scholarship on transnational TV drama's audiences and fans, often itself produced by scholar fans, as simply having been assimilated into the TV industry, misses the range of different ways that transatlantic fandom can be performed, and the forms of distinction that are associated with them. In Reading Lost, Will Brooker muses on his experience of watching television out of time, following Lost as a weekly series of downloads close to the US broadcast, where, by the time a show reaches DVD, the season is complete, a finished text. The case is closed. The detection is over. Audiences coming along at this later point whether they are academics wanting to study Lost, or fans who are late to the party, cannot easily join the community of devotees puzzling over the program. The Lost follower may find him or herself isolated and out of time, with no obvious place within an online community that, perhaps quaintly, remains structured around traditional broadcast schedules and global geography. Accordingly, transatlantic audiences continue to face difficulties caused by time differences, even if broadcast schedules have become less relevant as a result of full season drops, and because different US and UK broadcasters have moved their transmission of specific episodes closer together in order to try and minimize piracy and illegal downloading or streaming. Lost's 2010 finale was shown on Sky One in the United Kingdom at 5 a.m, simultaneous with its West Coast American broadcast, meaning that hardcore fans in Britain could stay up or get up early to watch. Similarly, new weekly episodes of Twin Peaks: The Return have been simulcast with the United States on Sky Atlantic, airing at times such as 3:20 a.m, and US fans of Doctor Who shared in BBC America's social media simulcasting of the 13th Doctor announcement after ESPN had broadcast the 2017 Men's Wimbledon final, which started at 9 a.m. Eastern Time on Sunday, July 16th, in the United States. At such moments, fandom renders the United States and United Kingdom as part of a singular zone of consumption. But at other points, when there is less hyped-up news or less anticipated new content, fans may wait a day or two to catch up with programs from across the Atlantic. Or they may, as Brooker points out, discover and binge a program some appreciable time after it was current in TV and social media terms. Audiences are therefore called upon to navigate a series of transatlantic temporalities. Neither fans nor academics constitute a singular block reading TV in the same way, nor encountering it at the same time. The different time zones of the United States and United Kingdom, along with variations in broadcast schedules, mean that some fans will do their very best to integrate into non-national times, using whatever means they can to access a TV program. In Rogue Archives, Digital Cultural Memory and Media Fandom, Abigail DeKosnick refers to this as media time, defining it as consisting of the schedules mandated by the culture industries, production and sales cycles, the time of broadcasting in the network television industry, the time of drop dates in the online streaming industry. DeKosnick argues that, given the analysis and criticism of what's been termed by Matt Hills in Fan Culture's just-in-time fandom, whereby fans begin posting online as soon as they can after TV transmission. Live tweeting during broadcast would be another version of this. We can read in this work a wish for fan time to be different from media time, for fans to have their own performance times, that is, their own schedules for making and sharing performances that are not tied to media time. This is a fair commentary on arguments from Fan Cultures, which suggested that fans were in danger of becoming overly enmeshed within industrial rhythms and temporalities. However, the transnational, and specifically transatlantic, disavowal of time zones in favour of simulcasting, however odd the national time it leads to, creates an unusual and rather different industrial position. Here, media time is adjusted in favour of DeKosnick's fan time, just as midnight screenings or midnight shop openings recognise fans' desire to gain immediate access to their fan object, as well as operating at least partly outside of mainstream norms of consumption as a marker of fan distinction. Transatlantic simulcasts, therefore, facilitate a fanish zone of consumption, staying up until 3 a.m. Greenwich Mean Time plus one to watch Twin Peaks is undoubtedly a performance of fan dedication, as well as combating online piracy. In Time Passing, modernity and nostalgia, Sylvian Agajinsky argues that we live in the time of the media and their programs, but rather than generalizing a mediatized time, contemporary transnational fandom demonstrates that a temporary slippage between time zones can be promoted for transatlantic event TV. Where US or UK media industries do not recognize and validate fans' desires to switch between different time zones, then fandom can take the matter into its own hands, of course. For example, there were lengthy delays between Sherlock's UK and US broadcast dates prior to the Abominable Bride special, which aired in both countries on January 1, 2016. As a result, series 1 to 3 were accessible to US fans only via illegal downloads immediately after their UK premieres. This situation, which licensing broadcasters such as the BBC have increasingly sought to avoid, gives rise to user-led transnationalism, where fans refuse to accept the limitations of official industrial circulations of texts. And, as fans discuss TV programs online, they often state where they are from in the course of any substantial interchange with other users. And this locative aspect of self-presentation remains important to the meanings being drawn out by others. Adrian Athik goes on to argue that fans are able to enact and observe the operation of grassroots international relations in real time. But these audiences are more than international, that is, where a national audience consumes TV drama from a different country of origin. Instead, these are necessarily transnational fans, not only combining national identities within their grouping, but also going beyond national identity in their constitution of a fan affinity and collective. It is because of this trans capacity, this going beyond the nation-state as a marker of identity, that some have argued that border-crossing fandoms should properly be thought of as transcultural, setting to one side the question of national affiliations and their imagined communities. Fans become fans of border-crossing texts or objects not necessarily because of where they are produced, but because they may recognize a subjective moment of affinity, regardless of origin. This is not to say that the nation is unimportant, but rather that it is but one of a constellation of possible points of affinity upon which transcultural fandom may be predicated. Nation-based differences or similarities may well appeal to people across borders, but so too might effective investments in characters, stories, and even fan subjectivities that exceed any national orientation. However, even when viewed as transcultural, fandom has a tendency to fall back into aspects of national difference, evaluation, and distinction, following well-established patterns of meaning-making. Sandra Annette characterizes this process of transcultural fandom as one built through flow, but also through friction. That is, transcultural fandoms involve fans setting aside national differences in favor of shared, effective investments in story worlds, at the same time that conflict accompanies this conjunction, precisely as a result of fans' interconnection across national and otherwise differences. Graham Turner has argued along related lines, suggesting that far from convergence culture and transnational Web 2.0 networks, rendering the nation-based analysis of television as a zombie category for both scholars and audiences and users alike, it has instead resulted as a reconfiguration of transnational identities. The transnational can represent less of an intrusion or disruption for contemporary fan audiences than a possibility to explore and perform newly emergent cultural distinctions. In this sense, transatlantic TV may be experienced very differently by audiences as compared to national institutions, for whom transnational, OTT industry players, can instead represent both an economic and a cultural threat. Piers Wenger, the BBC's current controller of drama, has strongly contrasted the BBC's expertise-driven culture of drama production to Netflix's allegedly algorithm-driven commissioning, suggesting that only the former can deliver genuine originality and innovation. Likewise, the director of BBC Arts, Jonty Claypole, has argued that while you can go to Netflix for a wonderful snack or a wonderful feast of a single thing, I think the BBC's role as an arts provider is going to become more and more unique. By this, he means that the BBC can offer cross-platform themed programming, with specific TV dramas being scheduled within moments of national interest, such as 2016's Pan-BBC Online and Broadcast Shakespeare Festival. Russell T. Davies' reworking of A Midsummer Night's Dream formed part of this commemoration of the 400th anniversary of Shakespeare's death, while 2017 involved a less stereotyped view of national interest via the BBC's Gay Britannia series, this time commemorating the 50th anniversary of the 1967 decriminalisation of homosexuality in the United Kingdom. But if the current reconfigurations of national and transnational dimensions of cultural identity can be productive for fan audiences, and yet rather more threatening to national broadcasters, how might these industrial and audience discourses intersect and interact? National broadcasters need to engage with globalized markets, to be sure, and thus it comes as little surprise to see an increase in BBC-Netflix co-productions. Nation-based producers also need to draw on national meanings and brandings that can circulate successfully on a transatlantic and a global stage, something that a big hit show such as Sherlock has done extremely well. But as transatlantic articulations of TV drama arguably become more visible and more clearly marked in Yort's terms, then audience discourses can, in turn, work to effectively co-create the category of transatlantic TV drama by amplifying and validating these textual markers of transnationalism, whether through blogged reviews, Tumblr expressions of emotion, or tweeted sentiments of transcultural fandom. As should be apparent through our focus thus far on transnational theory, television markets, transatlantic scholarship and fandom, many topics and approaches are covered across this collection. Despite such diversity, or perhaps thanks to it, a few central issues and themes emerge. Many of these are no doubt applicable across the US and UK context, and as similar disruptions and rearrangements take place around the globe. We will close by summarizing a number of these themes: transnational co-production, partnerships and representations, at the same time as introducing the chapters to follow. Structuring issues. Given the many tensions and innovations that mark the long-standing relationship between US and UK broadcasters and producers, not to mention their shared audiences, it is not surprising that several of these chapters focus on an old practice in a new setting: transnational co-production. Co-production has become a bigger factor in television drama than ever before, and several chapters discuss its permutations and dominant trends, cutting across industries, texts, and fan activity. While Michele Hilmes places US public television's longest-running dramatic showcase, Masterpiece, in historical perspective, she also lays out some of the ways that the economic and decision-making relationship between its British and American co-production partners has shifted over the last few decades, to the benefit, she argues, of both. Eva Vavil's chapter picks up the case of one of Masterpiece's greatest hits, Downton Abbey, to examine the incentives for both British and American production partners to break out of traditional dramatic modes, combining elements of both popular and quality texts to create a transnationally successful hybrid. Robin Nelson looks at a different set of creative relationships in his chapter on Rome and Parade's End, both involving a partnership between the US pay cable giant HBO and the BBC. In tracing how residual tensions still exist in the practice of co-production, between public service and commercial entertainment, between quality and popular programs, Nelson illuminates the motivations of each partner in an increasingly competitive business. And on the audience side, Matt Hill's focus on the Channel 4-originated Netflix-continued anthology drama Black Mirror, arguing that that fandom has become distinctly multi-discursive within the current contexts of transatlantic television flow. Building on his work in Crossing Fandoms, Paul Booth examines a transatlantic fan community organized around three distinct TV dramas, WB and CW's Supernatural and the BBC's Sherlock and Doctor Who, which are playfully amalgamated by these fans into Super Who-lock. Though it is stretching the term co-production a bit to extend it to the production of fan spaces and narratives, these authors show that, through the discursive spaces created by fans around these programs, meanings and interpretations are effectively co-produced and disputed into a transatlantic space. Overall, this thematic thread demonstrates that, while the old policy-grounded mandates for emphasizing national culture over more culturally hybrid approaches have been largely overturned, nationally specific tensions still exist and are being played out in different terms and over different terrains. Related to co-production, but going beyond specific programs to examine larger entities, a second theme recurs around new transnational relationships and how they require us to adjust our thinking about incentives, traditions, and proximities. On the industry side, Christine Becker looks at the transformation of the cable channel BBC America from a UK-owned outreach to the US cable market based on British programmes to a half-US-owned, high-profile space for both imported and original productions from all over, whose breakout show was the Canadian-produced sci-fi drama Orphan Black. She argues that BBC America's Britishness now serves as a form of transnational coding, whose value lies in its role as a key node in the transnational networked relationship between BBC Worldwide, the BBC, and AMC networks. Tracing a similar shift in her chapter, Roberta Pearson argues that the concept of cultural proximity, as developed by Straubar and others in the 1990s, needs to be expanded in the contemporary transatlantic context, to allow for more flexible relationships between industries, texts, and audiences. She proposes a cultural proximity index that recognizes that there is a spectrum ranging from the negative to the positive, cultural discount to cultural accessibility to cultural premium, illustrating its markers and effects in a comparison of Elementary in the United Kingdom and Sherlock in the United States. Likewise, Lincoln Garrity's examination of the transformation of the San Diego Comic-Con from a US-based comic and sci-fi-oriented convention to a place where a wide range of international media meet and mingle shows how important the British brand, promoted through such shows as Doctor Who, has become for both fans and industry. Lori Morimoto expands further into the space of transatlantic audiences by looking at the online relationship between British and American fans, contrasting the tension between cultural specificity and American monoculture in transnationally popular programs with the practices of Coronation Street fans in Canada, where cultural differences are valued as part of the transnational experience. Amid these changing relationships and practices, new ways of representing and framing, or as we might say, marking, transnationalism have begun to emerge. Karen Petruska and Faye Woods interrogate the use of the word original to describe international programs on Netflix and its competitors, arguing that it has lost its traditional meaning, linking texts to a specific site of production or commissioning. Instead, they conclude, such discursive framings advance a consistent narrative that SVOD services are global, innovative, and productive, and that their programs transcend national identities and cultures. Jonathan Bignall demonstrates that one such program, HBO series Episodes, in fact represents an extended inquiry into just such contentious conceptual shifts. The show makes transatlantic relationships visible and reflexively plays them out, as it tells the story of British television writers transported to Hollywood. It is a self-reflexive discourse about discourses that are already highly caricatured, working out the dislocations of transnational television. In their chapter, focused on acting in Game of Thrones, Simone Knox and Gary Cassidy, one a media studies scholar, one a professional actor turned academic, explore the basis for the long-standing binary that associates British acting with technique and American acting with spontaneity. Noting the increasing transnational mobility of British actors appearing in US-based productions, they provide an in-depth analysis of two scenes in the series and show how two British-trained actors have adapted their technique to the demands of transnational serial production. On the industry side, Sam Ward investigates the ways that the Sky Atlantic channel represents a transnational identity as a pipeline for quality American programs through its exclusive rights to HBO and Showtime dramas. Using a strategy and imagery of transnational bridging on screen and off, Sky Atlantic seeks to make transnational brand integration visible on the screen. And Paul Rickson turns to critical reception analysis in his chapter on one key site of reception discourse in the United Kingdom, The Guardian's television blogs, to discover the terms in which UK critics discuss quality US programmes and what that can tell us about the role of television criticism today in the transnational context. Through this exploration of contemporary transatlantic drama industries, texts and audiences, linked by common themes around co-production, relationships and representations, we hope that these chapters not only illuminate a significant sector of the transatlantic US and UK television phenomenon, but provide some insights that can be applied to other sites of transnational exchange. What other long-standing circuits of co-production have been transformed by digital streaming platforms in the same or different ways? What other transnational relationships have arisen or will arise as platforms like Netflix extend globally, expanding the collision and interaction of national televisual cultures, and what new platforms will arise out of such partnerships? Crucially, how will the resulting cultural collisions be represented to their audiences of critics, viewers, and fans alike? Will they be acknowledged or obscured, clearly or falsely marked, provide productive or disruptive experiences, stimulate creativity or create antagonism? And what kind of representations, uses, and meanings will audiences themselves create? Although we have flagged it up here, this new phase of scholarship has only begun. Part 1. Transatlantic Industries. Introduction. This part of the book primarily discusses recent developments in the media industry that underlie the rise of transatlantic television drama, keeping in mind that, although the UK and US exchange has been a particularly lively and important one, these trends are occurring around the world. The chapters define media industry broadly as encompassing the sweep of practices concerned with the production and distribution of television drama in today's digital environment, covering contemporary television's major platforms, traditional broadcast or terrestrial TV, cable and satellite television channels, and digital streaming services. Thus, in these four essays, concerns as diverse as political and cultural contexts, policy and regulation, economics, marketing, and technological infrastructure are examined, the framework behind creative conditions in television drama that produce contemporary texts and their audiences. The first chapter, Making Masterpiece Matter, the transnational cultural work of America's longest-running drama program by Michele Hilmes, focuses on the history behind the transatlantic trade, the forces and conditions that, at first, limited the scope of the US and UK special relationship, but later began to drive its expansion. In particular, the practice of transnational co-production between Britain and the United States is traced through the lens of one particular program, Masterpiece Theatre, or simply Masterpiece as it is now known, on the American Public Broadcasting Network, PBS. One of the first concerted efforts to distribute primarily BBC-produced television drama to American audiences in the 1970s, it contributed to the growth of the heritage drama genre in the United Kingdom, drawing from a broader range of producers. Along the way, the co-production relationship forged between Masterpiece and British broadcasters sparked a host of transatlantic tensions around the touchy area of television's role as a producer of national culture, as well as an avenue for foreign influences, still resonant today. Thanks, in no small part, to its British connection, PBS has expanded from a small, primarily educational channel to one that competes with the largest commercial networks in the United States. Complicating the transatlantic picture further, in Chapter 2, Traveling Without a Passport, Original Streaming Content in the Transatlantic Distribution Ecosystem, Karen Petruska and Faye Woods challenge one of the basic concepts underlying the transnational TV trade. From a historical context in which terms like original link cultural products with a situated authorship rooted in national identity, a British show is one produced in Britain by British creators who have taken a primary hand in its production. Today's digital streaming services such as Netflix and Amazon muddy those waters by, in many cases, attempting to sever the traditional link between production and location and to re-articulate it as a dislocated business practice. Thus, a Netflix original may have nothing to do with any originating creative effort on the part of Netflix, but instead denote a program's first appearance in a new market. An erasure of authorship and identity, as an example of the kind of strategic false marking of identity that is as old as television itself, but is given far more power and reach by today's global streaming platforms. In Chapter 3, Christine Becker, who has previously written on the rise of another pioneering transatlantic venture, the US-based but BBC worldwide-owned cable channel BBC America, focuses here on its transformation from a UK service presenting British programmes on US cable to a US-dominated outlet, not just for British TV per se, but what she calls British-branded television. BBC America, cloning drama for a transnational network, argues that, in the wake of its partial acquisition by US-based AMC Networks in 2004, the channel shifted away from an emphasis on its British roots toward a schedule built on high-quality, auteur-driven drama that might come from anywhere in terms of corporate ownership, but still holds on to key aspects of Britishness, built up by the transatlantic, now global, trade since the 1970s. This is a quite different Britishness than that promulgated by Masterpiece. Instead, using shows like the Canada-produced drama Orphan Black to link the network to a more youthful, edgy identity, built up by other British imports like Doctor Who and Top Gear. Becker details the forces operating on AMC's business strategies, both transnationally and domestically, specifically in the hypercharged competition for cable carriage in the United States, as well as BBC Worldwide's ambitions to build its reputation as a global brand, despite the increasingly US-dominated face presented by BBC America. Chapter 4 turns to the case of Sky Atlantic, A satellite channel launched in 2011 by Sky, the United Kingdom's largest subscription television provider. In his chapter, Branding Bridges, Sky Atlantic, Quality Imports and Brand Integration, Sam Ward explores both the business and the promotional strategies used by Sky to mark its place as the leading provider of American quality television in Britain. He develops the concept of transnational bridging as both an industrial practice and a discursive device used to position Sky Atlantic as a bridge between British and American television culture. Focusing on a series of initial idents put out by the network itself that quite literally juxtapose scenes associated with the United States with others from the United Kingdom. He argues that such narratives work not only to create a new way for British audiences to understand the American drama beamed into their midst, but to craft an identity for Sky TV as a purveyor of a brand of quality that reflects the changing status of US-produced drama in Britain. This part's four chapters set up a historically based framework for understanding the industrial and technological shifts that informed contemporary transnational television drama, specifically between the United States and United Kingdom, but by implication, around the world. In the next part, transatlantic texts themselves are explored for the ways in which negotiations of national culture and identity play out within the programs and in the ways that we might understand them, and the increasingly prolific culture work they perform. 1. Making Masterpiece Matter. The transnational cultural work of America's longest-running drama program. Michele Hilmes. After decades of derision and critical neglect, the fortunes of Masterpiece, formerly Masterpiece Theatre, the United States' longest-running primetime drama program, are on the rise. Making its debut on the nascent Public Broadcasting Service, PBS, in 1971, the anthology-style drama showcase quickly became PBS's top-rated primetime program. Its Sunday night slot, a fixture in a small but dedicated subset of homes across the United States. A transnational enterprise from the very beginning, in its early years it relied on serial drama productions imported from Britain, both literary adaptations and original drama, during a time in which funding pressures drove the BBC.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.